Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and in this video, we will be discussing the thyroid and parathyroid glands. So we will start with a little bit regarding function, realizing that we will spend considerably more time with these glands in the endocrine content. Then we're going to discuss the location, because we will be seeing these, and the prolific vascular supply these glands have. The thyroid and parathyroid glands are endocrine glands. In fact, the thyroid gland is actually the largest endocrine gland in the body. You can kind of see it right here on this image. Endocrine organs or glands will secrete a chemical signal called a hormone. Sometimes they will release multiple types of hormones into extracellular fluid, often to make its way to the bloodstream. Endocrine glands are also ductless, which is one of the things that separates them from their friends exocrine glands. Now, I don't want to go into too much detail in terms of the hormones that these glands release, as that would be less gross anatomy, but will certainly be discussed in detail in upcoming blocks by other experts. However, it's a nice opportunity to at least introduce these names, and so you can start getting familiar with the terms. So the thyroid gland will release thyroid hormone, which will help control rates of tissue metabolism. So this will be needed in adequate amounts for protein synthesis. Additionally, it will release calcitonin if blood levels get too high. So in essence, it will lead to a decrease in blood calcium levels. Parathyroid hormone, which will be released by the parathyroid glands, will kind of do the opposite of calcitonin, leading to increases and blood calcium levels, and is hugely important in terms of regulation of blood calcium levels. And as I mentioned, don't get too bogged down in terms of the functions of these specific hormones quite yet. I mainly wanted to just mention them or introduce them so you could at least hear them, and it will sound familiar once you explore these details later on. Okay, but where I really want us to focus on, or focus our attentions on, are kind of the more gross anatomy aspects. And one of these is the basic location of the thyroid and parathyroid glands, as well as its vascular supply. The thyroid gland, which is this large butterfly-shaped gland, has two lobes, a middle isthmus right here. This will typically be located between around the C5 vertebrae, cervical vertebrae 5, and T1 or thoracic vertebrae 1. And as you can see in this image, it is anterior to the larynx as well as the trachea, and deep to the infrahyoid muscles, as we discussed when we discussed those muscles. Now, what is neat is that the parathyroid glands are typically located on the posterior thyroid glands. So we're looking at a posterior view here, and you can see these little bitty little parathyroid glands on the posterior part of the thyroid gland. Sometimes it looks like it's a part of the thyroid gland, but certainly they're functionally different, and they don't have to be located here either. They can be found anywhere in this general area, but this is the most typical place, and there are typically four parathyroid glands, two sets of superior ones, two superior ones and two inferior ones, but there certainly can be more or less. There's all types of variability with the parathyroid glands, but this is kind of the most typical location. All endocrine glands have a very robust vascular supply. Both types of glands will be supplied by the superior and the inferior thyroid arteries, although the parathyroid glands typically gain most of their supply from the inferior thyroid arteries. The superior thyroid artery is a branch of the external carotid, which you can see. The external carotid is going to be up here. This is the common carotid. So you can kind of see it coming off the external carotid to supply the superior portion of the gland. The inferior thyroid artery is a branch of the subclavian artery, which is more down towards the root of the neck region. And I want you to note here, so you can see the inferior thyroid artery, note this close relationship, as the circle would indicate, between the inferior thyroid artery and the recurrent laryngeal nerve, which is this in yellow. If any type of surgery needs to be done on this area around the thyroid gland, such as a thyroidectomy, and the inferior thyroid artery needs to be ligated or tied off for this surgery, a surgeon needs to be mindful of this close relationship and not injure this nerve. If damaged, if the recurrent laryngeal nerve is damaged, this could lead to hoarseness in the voice or of the patient, or more severely, it could lead to paralysis of most of the intrinsic laryngeal muscles on one side. So this is a close anatomical relationship, something you hear often. There are typically three sets of veins that drain these glands. The superior thyroid vein will run close to the to the superior thyroid artery, which you can see here. The middle thyroid vein would be more in the middle, but it's important to note that these may or may not be present. There's a lot of variability with the middle thyroid vein. And the inferior thyroid veins are typically the largest. You can kind of see them around this area here. They're kind of independent, and you will often see them more in the midline region. So you can kind of see it kind of running superficial to the trachea here. So that's a interesting and close relationship there. One last big picture clinical note. The thyroid gland can increase in size, and sometimes it can increase considerably. And this increase of the thyroid gland size is called a goiter. This can be caused by a multitude of factors, which we're going to let some of your upcoming clinical lectures discuss, such as iodine deficiency or hypothyroidism. But on a more anatomical note, think about what could happen if the thyroid gland increases in size substantially. What's kind of missing in these rather simplistic images? All of that neurovasculature that we saw over here. So if you had an increase in size of the thyroid gland, it could compress some of that neurovasculature. You can also see that it could feasibly compress parts of the larynx or the trachea, but it's usually more that neurovasculature that's going to be deep that would be most commonly compressed in certain increases in size of the thyroid gland. Excellent! So much fun to touch on the first two glands we will be seeing for this year, and we will obviously have quite a few more to touch on throughout the year. Here is your summary slide with big picture takeaway concepts. Thank you for your time and attention here, and have a great rest of your day.